Hi everyone, so today I'm going to be talking about the new House Resolution Bill, H.R. 10044, or it's also known as the Fairness for High-Skilled Immigration Act of 2019, which is also the most recent iteration of the Fairness for High-Skilled Immigrations Acts, similar to H.R. 392 from last year. We're bringing this up now because the bill has passed the House, S-386, so it faces a lot of uncertainty before it gets a vote, so we want to clarify some misconceptions about it. The reason why it has a lot of holdup is because of the fact that Senator Chuck Grassley from Iowa, he wants many amendments onto the bill, and another senator, Rand Paul from Kentucky, also has his own Believe Act, which is another form of immigration reform that could take up floor space. As of now, the American Association for Immigrant Lawyers, or AILA, has said, quote, "Given the divergent impact on our members' clients, AILA has not taken position on the bill. However, as we recognize the significant impact of this legislation would have on our member practices if enacted, AILA is committed to providing updates on the status of this legislation, which is the stance of this law firm, which is why we're making this video now." The main component of the bill is that it will raise the per-country limits of family-based immigration visas from 7% to 15% for per-country limits, and also eliminate the per-country limits on EB visas. In the status quo, for both family and employment-based visas, there's a percentage cap of the total amount of visas that can be given out and distributed for each specific country. Right now, that limit for employment-based visas is 7%. So even though there is also a hard limit, of that hard limit, only 7% can go to one specific country. Post-bill, a cap will still exist for the family-based visas, but not for employment-based visas, which will significantly reduce the backlog in larger countries where they have been limited by this cap previously. As for family immigration, it will probably impact countries more along the lines of the Philippines and Mexico. Also, for employment-based visa applicants, the bill will establish a 3-year transition period to make sure the elimination of the per-country cap will go smoothly. First of all, it will preserve the number of EB visas going to smaller countries, which will allot X amount of all the EB2, EB3, and EB5 visas to immigrants not from the top 2 countries with the largest number of natives. In 2020, that percentage, X, will be 15%, and for the next 2 years, it will be reduced down to 10 before it's all gone. But during that transition period, no more than 85% of all the visas will be allotted to immigrants from a single country, which means that one country will not dominate the market. Another component of the bill would be that it will eliminate a provision within the Chinese Student Protection Act of 1992, which requires that an annual immigrant visa limit for China be reduced by 1,000 visas annually to offset adjustments under this act. That will be eliminated, but it won't really have much of an effect. Also, the most different part about this bill is that it has a, quote, "do no harm" provision, which provides that beneficiaries of employment-based immigration petitions approved before the bill's enactment will receive their visa no later than if the bill was never enacted in the first place. This provision does not apply to pending employment-based visas or family-sponsored immigrant petitions, which we'll talk about why this is significant later on. So what's the impact to this bill? First of all, for employment-based visas, it will significantly shorten the EB2 and EB3 wait times for larger countries like China or India. The waiting times for these visas will be much shorter in the larger countries, but for the smaller countries, which usually do not send that many applicants, the wait times could go up. Still, there would be an overall balance. The impact to EB1 applicants, though, is complicated, and probably there won't be much change to how long it'll take now in the waiting time for EB1 visas. Yet, Congress may also take further actions later on when seeing an influx of workers to maybe modify the INA, or Immigration Nationality Act, to increase the annual quota for employment-based immigrants in order to address all the needs of all the applicants. Overall, we think that if you are an applicant, do not panic, and try to support legislative initiatives that increase the total number of immigrants who can come to the United States. You should also try to fill out your immigration petition as soon as possible, because there will be more and more applicants after this bill is passed and into the future, the more than the annual quota, which is why there is this bill to begin with. If you act fast now and file your application early, you will have a better spot within the queue. In addition, the bill's current version guarantees a better spot for those whose I-184 petition has already been approved, which means that this bill might not pass in this year, but it will probably pass next year or in the future. And as an individual or a prospective immigrant, whatever your stance is, you should take an action by starting your application as soon as possible rather than later.